Welcome to our Dechert On Demand video series. We are looking at hot topics for fund managers. This particular video will focus on a very hot topic in the private equity world, which is that of secondaries. I have with me today a panel consisting of Francesca Paveri, who's a director at Evercore, John Kettnich, a partner at StepStone Group, and Anne Charlotte Riviere, who is one of my partners in the Corporate and Securities Group in Paris. I'm going to let each of my panelists introduce themselves in a little bit more detail, and then we'll dive straight into some questions and answers on this subject. So if I could start with you, Francesca, perhaps you could just introduce yourself and say what you do.
Absolutely, thank you. Francesca Paveri, I'm a managing director in the London team of Evercore in a team that we call Private Capital Advisory. And what we focus on is advising investors in private equity funds that are looking for liquidity. So family offices, pension plans, insurance companies, fund of funds that are looking to use the secondary market to sell one interest or a portfolio of interests in private assets. So it can be private funds, I should say. It can be real estate, it can be buyout, it can be venture, it can be infrastructure and private credit. In addition to that, a good part of our business is focused on advising GPs that are looking to use the secondary market to find, to create some liquidity solutions for their investor base. And so all the transactions that I'm sure you've heard talking about quite a lot lately, what we call GP-led transactions.
Thank you, Francesca. And John, perhaps you could introduce yourself.
Sure, yeah. So I'm a partner at StepStone Group. I work in the private equity team and really help kind of lead the secondary practice. It's something I've done really since we started doing secondaries at StepStone back in 2008. Really joined the firm in 2007 when the business was just getting started. I kind of helped grow the secondary business, spent time kind of working internationally in Beijing and London. But my passion has always been secondaries, and so really excited about kind of helping lead that team here at StepStone. You know, as a firm, we're really focused on advising and managing assets on behalf of some of the largest institutions around the world. Today, we advise and manage assets totaling about $333 billion in total. We're deploying about $50 billion a year across the private markets. About half of that is private equity. We have about 560 people that sit around the world across 19 different offices.
Thank you. And Anne Charlotte?
Yeah, so Anne Charlotte Riviere, I'm a partner from Dechert Paris office. I'm in part of the CNS group, which means that I'm working on the transactional part of the secondary transaction. So mainly the acquisition itself and not necessarily the fund formation. We team for that with our fund formation team. We are working extensively on secondaries on private equity funds. And as Francesca was saying, more recently we had lots of GP-led transaction or continuation fund to handle.
Thank you, Anne Charlotte. Francesca, if I may start with you first, could you give us some market context, some data points regarding the secondaries market during 2020, for example, the total value of deals transacted, the split between GP-led and how much was raised for secondary funds?
Yes, of course. So I would start with saying, you know, the secondary market experienced a very strong growth over the last 10 years. And in particular, I would say over the last 4 or 5 years. So if I think about the market in 2016, we recorded about 37 billion of transaction. Why, just to give you a sense, in 2019, we hit 80 billion. And of these, throughout the years, in the period of 2016 to 2019, about 33% of those transactions were in the form of GP-led transactions, whereas the vast majority of the deal flow was really the traditional secondary deals where an LP is looking to sell one fund or multiple funds as part of a portfolio. In 2020, the market took quite a pause post-COVID. So Q2 was very, very quiet. But then the reality is in that the last 4 or 5 months of the year, the market really picked up again and made up for the time that had been lost in Q2. So at the end, the year ended at 60 billion. So a good 25% down from the previous year, but still a great achievement, which I can tell you in April, we didn't think we could have got to. And the key difference versus the previous year was that actually over 50% of the deal flow, or the deals that actually happened, was in GP-led transactions, which translated into about 32 billion of deals. The previous year was 28 billion in GP-led. And to give you a sense, in 2016, we were only at 11 billion. So the growth of that part of the market has been sustained over the last 5 years, and we'll talk about why. The only thing I would add with respect to that is, you know, why all this growth? And I think the key driver has been the fundraising market for secondary funds. And I'm sure John will be able to speak about that. But when we look at 2020, there were about 80 billion of capital raised as part of fundraising effort by secondary funds. And that brought the dry powder at the end of the year to 113 billion. This is the result of a survey we do every year. And keep in mind that 113 billion is equity, which is in the hands of secondary buyers. So it's dedicated secondary capital. On top of that, you always have to keep in mind that there is a lot of capital which is not dedicated to secondaries. So it can be pension plans, sovereign wealth fund that do secondary on an opportunistic basis. Plus there's leverage that is a significant component of a lot of the deals. So that makes us very comfortable that you actually probably have more than 200 billion of capital out there for every year of deals that we do. And obviously it makes us comfortable that it's gonna keep growing.
Thanks. Thanks for that, Francesca. So no doubt included in those data points would be StepStone's Secondaries Fund 4. So John, you guys achieved the final closing for your secondary opportunities Fund 4 last March at $2.1 billion, easily surpassing your target of $1.25 billion. So could you tell us what the key drivers were behind your success in raising Fund 4?
Yeah, sure, I'd be happy to. Look, we were very fortunate in our fundraising. You know, I do think there's some broader kind of macro tailwinds just around the strategy. I think a lot of LPs are catching on to the fact that secondaries have been some of the best risk-adjusted returns really earned in the market over the last 20 years. And so that certainly helps. But, you know, when I think about kind of our personal success, I really think about it in kind of three key areas. You know, one, really just our relationship, you know, and our relationships with our clients and our limited partners. You know, we've really kind of built our platform centered around serving those clients and those LPs, trying to customize solutions for them. And frankly, our secondary practice really was born out of, you know, client demand years and years ago. But you know, we try to build that transparent relationship, and I think LPs really value that. We have a terrific team at StepStone, so I credit really a lot of that success to our team and the team that we've been able to build. We've got 86 different private equity investment professionals around the world, and I said, you know, 560 people. But importantly, really that team is all motivated to help, you know, our secondary business, you know, economically aligned to really kind of drive the success of our secondary platform as well as other parts of our business. And then, you know, I think the other piece is just, you know, as you've seen the market mature, I think it's really important for institutions to really have a focused strategy and be able to really clearly articulate why their strategy is differentiated. And you saw in the buyout industry, as that market matured, people started specializing. I think you're going to see the same thing in secondaries. And so for us to be able to articulate a very clear and concise strategy to our clients and prospects, I think really helped us kind of with our fundraising. So when I think about kind of what that is, it's really leaning on the backbone of StepStone, right? We're deploying $50 billion a year across the private markets. That means there's no GP we can't get access to. We're tracking 21,000 different funds, 8,000 different GPs. So we have an information advantage. And so we use that, you know, really to kind of make a rifle shot approach, find single fund, single manager transactions, whether that's buying LP interests, GP-led deals, but really leverage that relationship and that information advantage to, you know, make better informed decisions, you know, than our peers. And so, you know, we think that was a really big contributor to our success.
Thanks, thank you for that. So just going back to what one of the few things that you said earlier, Francesca, about the COVID last year, essentially putting the market on pause for a little while. And you know, yourselves, we, Dechert, saw the market come back to life somewhat in Q4 last year. You also mentioned, you know, the huge amount of dry powder that is available in the market. So what is your prediction for deal activity this year and possibly also going into next year? And in particular, you know, which areas do you see most activity occurring in?
Yeah, absolutely. Listen, 2020 was a very interesting year. Q2, as I was saying before, really saw a pause. And then there were very little number of transactions. There were a few, I would say, distressed LPs, but really exceptions, and a few GPs that use the secondary market to support their portfolio and to sometimes in the form of pref equity in order to really find some full-on capital to inject into the companies. But these, I would say, were really exceptions. Then since the summer, the market has picked up again. And there were, I would say, two trends. One is the GP-led transactions. So the vast majority of the deals last year, as I was saying, were GP-led transactions and situations where GPs were using the secondary market to offer liquidity to their LPs. And most of the cases, it was very concentrated deals, very often single assets, which GPs felt, this is an asset that I want to hold for longer. It's a great business. I know the management team better than anyone else. And I just want to find a solution that allows me to hold this for longer, but at the same time, give liquidity to my LPs that in the moment of a life in which it makes sense to give some liquidity. And so a lot of the concentrated deals, single asset transactions came to life, much more than in previous years. And I think this is something that we are seeing going into 2021, and we expect to continue. And I think this is, you know, it was about 14 billion of deals last year, which were single assets. I wouldn't be surprised if this doubles over the next couple of years. It's really become a new tool that GPs have available. Then on the other side, the LP market was very, very quiet, as I was saying. Post-COVID, we were all expecting, is there going to be some denominator effect? Is there going to be some distress LP? Reality is we saw that didn't happen, partially because the LPs were well capitalized, partially because the public markets recovered very fast. But so that part of the market was low. It picked up at the end of the year. I think some LPs started to get comfortable that they could receive a good price for their portfolios. And we saw it as part of the deals we brought to market for high quality portfolios and vintages that were not too old. You could really get, you know, par pricing, potentially small premiums. And this trend is continuing. So we are really seeing, I would say, the beginning of 2021 has seen a good amount of deal flow coming from the LP side. We generally see a pickup even later in the year as Q4 numbers come out, as LPs start to have their internal discussions around strategy and they decide what do they want to do with their portfolio. But it's definitely one part of the market which was very difficult to diligence for buyers last year because, you know, I'm sure John can confirm that if you were to get a portfolio with 20 funds, there was too many uncertainty within those 20 funds. Whereas when you were looking at a concentrated deal with just one or two assets, you could really spend time with the GP. So I think now that problem is not gone because you always have some tricky companies to evaluate, but in general, it's much easier to properly due diligence a portfolio. And what's that translating into is a good amount of or pick up in deal from that part. And what I would say is, LP buyers are definitely very keen to start seeing more of that because last year they have done a lot of concentrated deals, but at the end, you know, the majority of the portfolios the funds that secondary buyers have to deploy needs to go into diversified portfolios. This is the core of the secondary market, and I think we are seeing a lot of appetite from buyers on that side of the business. And maybe just the only thing I would add is, in terms of trend, the other part where we're seeing an increase in deal flow from an asset class perspective is infrastructure. and private credit. And this is just a translation of the maturity of those asset classes, which is starting to happen, and then LPs and GPs want to start to see some liquidity.
Yeah, thank you for that. Yeah, I agree. I mean, you know, I was on a call yesterday with one of our clients, an intermediary, and they were saying that they had a client or clients with between, you know, $500 to $1 billion to deploy into infrastructure assets, Europe in particular. So actually, that kind of segues neatly into a question I had for Anne Charlotte, which is, you know, I know you had a busy Q4 last year, transactional side. Which you know, industry sectors or areas did you see the most activity, whether, you know, on the buy side or the sell side?
We mainly acted on the buyer side last year. What was driven the deal we were working on were definitely GP-led. Most of them were GP-led, and in order to either find liquidity or to hold some assets that were good. So what Francesca is saying is clearly resonating on what we experience and what we are currently experiencing, because the beginning of Q1 is very active as well in such respect, and compared to last year, much more active as well. What we can see in the industry, we've seen a bit of infra, but what we have seen as well is interest for venture funds. So the underlying assets are venture companies that are getting more mature. And I think that this is resonating with what Francesca was saying as well about maturity of the assets, because the assets are getting more mature, the valuation are getting a bit stronger, and our clients are a bit less fearless than before about valuating those assets. While previously, those clients were only looking at LBOs, underlying assets. So this is really a trend that we have evidence. This raised challenge about the due diligence and also the structuring of such transactions. But this is very interesting to go through those kind of companies and to see how they get valuated, which kind of discount, how they set up the portfolio, which kind of maturity, because obviously you don't want to take too much risk, so it is more busy.
Thanks, thank you for that. So we've spoken a number of times about, you know, the challenging markets, and I guess, you know, question for you, John, private equity's mantra is value creation, value preservation. So in the midst of the ongoing, you know, global pandemic, what would you say are the key skills that are required to navigate, you know, the challenging types of markets that we're currently experiencing?
Yeah, sure. Look, I think, as Francesca said, Q2 last year was in part kind of very slow, just because it was very tough to evaluate, you know, risk return and, you know, what the likely outcome was for companies. You know, see, we were one of the few people that actually stayed pretty active. About 20% of the deal flow that we closed last year actually was sourced and closed in Q2. But, you know, it was challenging. And I think you had to kind of figure out, you know, what were areas and pockets of growth that would kind of withstand the current climate. But kind of when I think about the, you know, the traditional value creation, you know, that we think about, and, you know, for secondary investors, we don't really control a lot of those levers, but we're, you know, still tasked with understanding, you know, what is revenue growth, margin expansion, you know, potential multiple expansion, debt pay down of an underlying company, but they're somewhat out of our hands. And so, you know, I think it's challenging to underwrite that. It's gotten easier, you know, today than it was, you know, in Q2 last year, just kind of across the board, but it certainly is challenging. You know, when I kind of think about as a secondary investor, the tools that we have and that, you know, the value creation tools we really control, I think about it kind of in three ways. It's really, you know, it's price. What am I paying for assets? You know, and I would incorporate in, you know, the terms, right? So, you know, part of that cost is fees, carry, things like that, that are often, you know, a meaningful part of a GP-led secondary market. I think about it as quality. You know, what are the quality of the underlying companies that we're buying? And, you know, importantly, what's the quality of the sponsor that we're actually backing? You know, that, I think, to us is actually the primary driver of returns in secondaries. It's actually more about quality of companies and sponsor than it really is about, you know, the price that you pay. And then lastly, it's about, you know, what's the structure or capitalization? So are you adding leverage to magnify, you know, kind of risk and return? Are you thinking about a structure? I know those pref equity deals were certainly, you know, a hot topic a year ago. Not a lot of them got done as far as we can tell, but certainly a hot topic. You know, as I kind of think about those three metrics, you know, price, obviously pricing came down tremendously in Q2. You know, I think the stats that we see kind of quoted today really don't represent, you know, what was really truly felt in the market. Because, you know, most of the quotes out there just never traded, right? So somebody might have come down 50% on a price, but no LP was really willing to sell at that level. You know, today that pricing has come back in a pretty big way. So it's a different challenge, right? Back then you were buying, you know, declining asset values at a big discount, or you're trying to. Today, you know, there's a lot less discount, but you're buying off of an old record date. You're expecting assets to appreciate. So different challenge, but it's a challenge nonetheless. You know, on the quality side, you know, I think one of the things that's kind of overlooked a lot of times is just, you know, what is the relative risk of what I'm buying? And so for us, we focus really on, you know, buying that quality, high quality sponsors, high quality companies. And just to kind of frame that, we've done a lot of data analysis around loss ratios. And so if you look at, you know, what's the long-term average loss ratio for a top quartile fund, it's 11% over the long run. If you think about just those years pre-crisis, it tends to go up about 300 basis points to 14%. If you look at fourth quartile funds, that same those same stats, so long-term average is about 19% for a fourth quartile manager. In a pre-crisis vintage, that actually goes up to 37%, so 1,800 basis point increase. So you have to be very careful if you're buying kind of fourth quartile funds, part of why we just focus on avoiding that segment of the market. And then lastly, kind of around structuring, and I mentioned, you know, there's pref equity deals. There's a lot of talk about that. We haven't seen a lot of those deals get done. You know, for us, you know, on the leverage side, we're not big users of leverage. You know, the underlying assets have a fair amount. But for us, it's all about trying to understand, you know, what are the scenarios that can possibly happen, you know, even on the downside, you know, scenarios. And, you know, do you ever, you know, kind of run into issues with kind of adding, you know, adding risk and return through leverage? And then lastly, I'll say, you know, I think people sometimes put a little bit too much value in structure. I think structuring is great. It can really protect you. But if you buy garbage companies that aren't really worth anything, at the end of the day, that structure is absolutely worthless. And so we've seen a lot of people take comfort in a structure that ultimately doesn't really pan out and ultimately doesn't really add the value that they expected. So you have to be pretty careful around that.
Thanks for that. So Francesca, I mean, you and I both saw last year, because again, you know, COVID, et cetera, that the deals were on pause. A number of funds were coming to the end of their lives. So apart from the, you know, usual solutions of sell what you've got or try and extend the fund life, why would a GP want to consider doing a GP-led secondary in cases where you think that that is a better option? Could you shed some light on that?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think this links a bit to what John was saying around quality of GPs. The market has really changed over the last couple of years. You know, these GP-led transactions have always existed, or always since the secondary market exists. They used to be spin-offs from banks, from family offices. Then they became GP-led transactions around the zombie funds. So it was situations where a GP was not able to raise a new fund and was trying to find a solution to hold on to certain assets and be able to potentially get some primary capital to raise money. I think over the last 3-4 years, the market has completely changed from that perspective. And, you know, the clients we're working with today are the best GPs out there that have simply understood that there's a lot of capital that has been raised in the secondary market. This capital is flexible, it's creative, and it can allow the GP to solve certain solutions. So what does it, I would say, and so the negative connotation that secondary sometimes was attached to it, it sort of disappeared. And actually what we've seen, especially in the last year, is that the deal flow has been characterized by the best assets that the GPs hold. And so what GPs have started doing, and you know, with you know, with the having discussed with the LPs, having discussed with buyers, with advisors, is you look at your portfolio and you consider, is there any asset in here which it would make sense to sell because it would allow existing LPs to receive liquidity, but at the same time, it's an asset that we know well. It's a fantastic business. It has grown because of organic growth, add-on acquisitions, strategic, or maybe some transformational acquisitions. And we are the best one in terms of knowing management. Why not finding a structure that allows you to hold those assets? So the first type of solutions I would say that we've seen developing is this single asset. And when we talk about single asset, it's not only a fund that was maybe 10 year old and the fund is expiring, but sometimes it's a company that was bought 4 or 5 years ago. And the GP has already made, you know, several times their capital. And it's a good idea to return capital to the LPs, to crystallize return, to de-risk the fund, but still find a way to stay invested. So I would say single asset is one. The other one that we've seen over the last year was strip sales. So selling, let's say, 30% of a subset of companies within the portfolio. And I would say that's more of a either de-risking exercise. So maybe it's a, you know, it's a good asset, GP doesn't want to sell it, but at the same time, it would be good to send money back to LPs. And so they sell only a portion of the assets to a fund which they still manage and that sits parallel. And finally, the other reason to do that would be to raise follow-on capital, because sometimes the structure of the fund doesn't allow to do that. So I think these are probably the two new structures we've seen, which are not necessarily just old funds. So what I would say generally to GP and what we tell them when we see them is, you know, let's review your portfolio. Let's talk about it and see how can the secondary market find a solution and give you some creative ideas to serve the best interests of your LPs and ultimately also the GP. The deal needs to make sense also for the GP. Otherwise, you know, they wouldn't be doing it.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, you know, because the choice between simply extending for whatever is available another year or 2 years or winding up is very binary. Whereas with a GP-led, you know, you have, as you say, the opportunity to be creative and find, you know, solutions that I think, you know, better serve both the LPs as well as the GPs. But, you know, as we've also seen, you know, when these transactions do happen, they are pretty complicated in, you know, many cases. And you know, question for Anne Charlotte, you know, unlike conventional sale and purchases of LP interests, when we are talking about, you know, the complex GP-led deals, they are really just M&A transactions with a fund sort of overlay to them. So could you tell us, you know, from your perspective, some of the areas where a GP-led M&A transaction, you know, differs from just a conventional trading company to trading company M&A transaction?
One of the differences, and we've seen several transactions where GP were only disposing part of the portfolio, but keeping part of their interest in the underlying fund or companies. And in such scenario, that means that there are seller on one side, buyer on the other side, and keeping both lines. So obviously, one of the main challenge is to handle the conflict of interest and to make sure that it is properly handled. And that's something that you need to adjust, you know, at the time of the acquisition to start with, because there are both sides. So you need to make sure that there aren't any items that you haven't seen in the context of the due diligence that may impede your ability to then handle your conflict of interest and maybe the pari passu between the two firms. And you need to find a way to handle the follow-on properly if there are any follow-on and disposal as well, because sometimes you have some regulation, you know, within the GP in order to handle the conflict of interest in a way that is not comfortable for the acquirer at all, because that would mean that, for example, your seller will be in a position to dispose of the interest, you know, prior to the new acquirer. And these are things that you need to be very careful about when you're doing this kind of transaction. In those transactions, and we usually have, you know, a portion of primary investment as well. So there are quite a lot of discussion again about how to deploy those follow-on and how to use them, knowing that the GP would manage several funds. And finally, once again, about the conflict of interest, if the GP has disposed 30% of one interest once, he can then dispose again 30% for another acquirer in another transaction. And then you will have the issue again about the conflict of interest, not only with your seller, but with potential other follow-on or continuation fund. And so this is something that we usually discuss quite heavily, with the constraint when your buyer has already his conflict of interest rules that are set very strongly.
Thanks. Now, we're coming up to time, actually. So I'm going to try and wrap up 1 minute each for each of you with a sort of closing question. So let's start with Francesca again. What would you say existing investors should be mindful of when one of the GPs that they're invested in approaches them with a GP-led transaction?
Yeah, I think there's two points in time where they need to be, you know, they need to take ownership of the process. One is generally there will be a consultation with the advisory board. So if they sit on the advisory board, they will need to either review or approve the management of conflicts. And I think in that point in time, what's important to look at is how have conflict been dealt with? How was the process run? Whether the GP has looked to maximize price, whether the GP has been transparent in the process, what options are given to LPs. So it's more a question of process. And then the second point in which to be mindful is when they need to decide, what do I do? Because typically they would be given an option to invest somehow, or invest, roll, those different definitions. And I would say there it becomes more a question of assessing a new investment opportunity. And so you have to look at the asset, you have to speak to the GP to understand the businesses that are under question. You want to spend time with the GP to get as many insights you can. You want to spend time in the data room that has been prepared, and really understand, is this an interesting opportunity going forward? So I think it's important to separate these two points, but really, and try to get the help of the GP to make the right, or there's no right or wrong, actually, decision, but to make a decision in the right way, let's say, with the right process.
Thanks. And John, question for you is, where would you like to see, or what are the areas that you would like to see the industry grow in?
Yeah, sure. It's a great question. Look, I think we've seen a lot of growth on the LP side, for example. We've seen, you know, the friction costs of, you know, trading assets, you know, go down. We've seen, you know, standardization of terms and complexity of closing, you know, go become a lot easier, I think, over the years. And I'd love to see some more of that, I think, on the GP side. And I'd love to see, you know, certain expectations of GPs, LPs, secondary buyers to be a little bit more institutionalized, you know, certain GPs, you know, rolling carry, things like that, just to foster the right alignment and really try to avoid, you know, some of the conflicts, right? If GPs are taking a ton of cash off the table, and as Charlotte said, look, you're inherently conflicted if you're selling the asset to yourself. So just trying to kind of build in more practices that are just market standard for GPs, you know, not making a lot more money if they sell the asset into a continuation vehicle with twice the carry is another good example. So I'd love to see that, I think, on the GP-led side. And then just really industry-wide, I mean, I think there's a few issues that just, I think we've done as a private equity industry, maybe a little bit better around things like ESG, operational due diligence. You know, there's not really a lot of that has permeated into the secondary market. It's something that we focus a lot on at StepStone, but I think it's something that we're going to see and really need to see advancement on when it comes to, you know, assessing ESG risks as part of a secondary transaction, even in the context of, you know, buying 100 companies, which can be quite challenging. And same with operational due diligence. You know, that's not really part of the kind of diligence process that typically is afforded to buyers, but I think it's an important piece of the puzzle that we need to figure out longer term. And it's a big area of focus for us at StepStone.
Thank you. And Charlotte, so question for you. A buyer or a seller contemplating a single asset or a multi-asset sale and purchase transaction, what would you say are the sort of two or three key items that they should have at the top of their minds from a legal perspective?
Okay, so from a legal perspective, when you're selling assets, I think the first thing is to ensure the transfer process, because when you're acquiring a portfolio of assets, you will discriminate your price, and then you will come up with a global price and with a global discount, but everybody knows that the split is not as it is. So there will be sensibility at the level of the acquirer to actually make sure that the assets you trust the most would be transferred for sure. So they will put condition precedent for the first closing of the transaction, and understanding and being in a position to comfort him on the fact that it can be done within a month. It can be, it's easy, it's anticipated, it's something that is very important when you're selling. When you're acquiring, this is part of your due diligence to make sure on how this will do, this will transfer. Us as lawyer, we always ask our clients how they split the price, not to have the detail, but to understand what is essential to be transferred and if they have any sensibility to the number of closing, because sometimes you have transaction when you're transferring lots and lots of interest online and you have capital call, you know, every 2 weeks for very minimum amount. So you always put threshold there as well. And so there is a sensibility on the acquirer side, but on the seller side, it's important as well, because they know that they won't be able to transfer unless they reach a significant amount. So I would say that to anticipate that would make the process much smoother.
Thank you. So we are now actually slightly over time, but I would like to thank all three of you for your participation and for your deep thoughts and insights into this session. So with that, thank you for your participation.